great pleasure for me to be here on a very important platform of Tata Sky Fam Health.
Dear friends, it's really a great pleasure and honor indeed for me to be here on the occasion of a very important mission, Mission India Resistant Hypertension, a real tsunami not only in India but in the whole world. Time to act is now. This show is organized on a platform of Tata Sky Fam Health at Eros Hotel, New Delhi, India. The academic partner for this program is IPCA. I must tell you today, ladies and gentlemen, hypertension is a real problem for each and every one of us. Whatever profession we are, it's a real problem with a very high morbidity and mortality. Hypertension is a silent killer, is known to each and every one of us. If you see, the prevalence of hypertension is rising very steeply in our country. A time has come. We have to change our mindset. There should be a paradigm shift from illness to wellness. Until and unless we nurture the seed of wellness, we cannot control the hypertension. And the message should be very clear today, that a doctor and patient and a doctor and public relationship is the need of the hour. Doctors alone cannot fight with this menace. This menace is rising very steeply in our country. The prevalence is up to a tune of 35% to 45%. At the age of 40, 40% are hypertensive. At the age of 50, 50% are hypertensive. And at the age of 60, 60% are hypertensive. At the age of 80, 80% are hypertensive. We have to nurture a seed of wellness right from the time when a child is born. We see a lot of young hypertensives at the age of 35 and 40 with a lot of morbidity. So I think awareness is the need of the hour. Controlling hypertension is the need of the hour. If you really want to reduce brain attack, heart attack, leg attack, abdominal attack, and eye attack, every possible malady is the outcome and a complication of hypertension. We have a very expert panel. This is a national panel from India of the cardiologist of international repute. All these cardiologists who are sitting before you are the face of India to create a global impact. I think this is going to be a very, very unique session and a very powerful session with all the messages, what we should do and what we should not do. Ladies and gentlemen, without wasting any time, I'd like to introduce to you the eminent panel and then we'll start the interaction. To my right is Professor C.N. Manjunath. He is the Director and Chief of Jayadeva Institute of Cardiovascular Sciences and Research, Bengaluru. He is Padam Shri and he is a tremendous contribution in the field of cardiology and his voice carries a lot of meaning for the public. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
To the right of Professor C.N. Manjunath is Professor G.S. Wander. He is a man who is the head of the Department of Cardiology from Dayanand Medical College and Hospital, and also HERO DMC Heart Institute. He is also an awardee, B.C. Roy awardee, and a past president of Association of India, and was also the section editor of cardiology in the very prestigious book, API textbook of cardiology. He is a very, very eminent person with enormous information, and he is the face of hypertension from India to the world. We welcome you, Dr. Wander, sir. To my extreme right, Dr. C.K. Pandey, who is coming all the way from Mumbai. He is in PD, Hinduja National Hospital and Medical Center and Research Center from Mumbai. He is a speaker par excellence. And he is an interventional cardiologist and electrophysiologist. He has a zeal of educating public and to have an awareness on a hypertension like this. To my left is a very eminent person. I know words to express. I know him for the last 37 years. He is the face of India in the whole world on interventional cardiology and electrophysiology, Professor T.K. Sethi. He is the CMD of Delhi Heart and Lung Institute and is the past president of Cardiological Society of India as well as past president of Society of Electrocardiography. He is a Padam Shri. He is an enormous publication to his credit, and he is a powerful orator, a powerful interpreter, and a powerful expression which you will listen from him very shortly on hypertension. To the left of Professor Sethi is Dr. M.K. Das. He is the president-elect of Society of Cardiology, Cardiological Society of India, and he is a senior consultant interventional cardiologist at Birla C.K. Birla Hospital, Kolkata. He has come all the way from Kolkata to participate on this important mission India. I welcome you, Dr. Das. To the left of Dr. Das is Dr. Viveka Kumar, who is a senior director, cath lab, and a senior director from the Department of Electrophysiology, Max Heart and Vascular Institute, Saket, and he has tremendous contribution in interventional cardiology, not only in India, but in the whole world. He has a tremendous interest in the public education on the heart ailments. I welcome you, Dr. Viveka Kumar. To my extreme left, Dr. A.K. Pancholia, who has come all the way from Indore. He is the head of the Department of Cardiology in Arihan Hospital from Indore. He is a powerful orator, a powerful speaker, and a communicator, and go to the masses and runs many courses in hypertension in Indore and in whole of Madhya Pradesh. So we have very eminent faculty here before you. I will ask my first question to Dr. A.K. Pancholia. Dr. Pancholia, it's very important for the public to know what is blood pressure. Is it really necessary? Is it necessary for us to measure the blood pressure? What are the methods by which we can measure the blood pressure? What a public should know? And what is the target level of blood pressure which is required? Dr. Pancholia, sir.
There are two limits of the blood pressure. The upper limit is called the systolic blood pressure, which is mainly related to the contraction of the heart, while the lower limit is the diastolic blood pressure, which is related to the relaxation of the heart. These are the norm. Ideal blood pressure is 120 millimeter. It is actually recorded in the millimeter of mercury, and upper limit is 120 millimeter of mercury, and lower limit is 80 millimeter of mercury. That is the ideal blood pressure where we do not get any heart problem or any brain problem. Blood pressure is actually measured by an instrument which is called a sphygmomanometer, and where the cuff is actually wrapped around the arm and it is inflated to cut off the blood circulation, and the doctor actually record the flowing of the blood over the artery, and then it is gradually deflated, and when the rush of the blood is there, then it produces first sound, which is called the which is actually related to the systolic blood pressure. And when it fades away, then it is called the diastolic blood pressure. Blood pressure in the younger age group, the blood pressure when it is normal, then it is to be recorded once in every 3 to 5 years. But in the elderly patients, when the blood pressure is normal, then it is to be recorded once in a year or so.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pancholia, for your words of wisdom. I think with this we proceed and ask our other expert panelist, Professor K.K. Sethi, what is the definition of resistant hypertension? How does it occur? What are the components of resistant hypertension? What are the factors which influence resistant, cause the hypertension to be resistant, and how we can prevent it? Professor K.K. Sethi, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Chopra, for this question. I think the question is very pertinent. Resistant hypertension, as the word itself suggests, is something that is not responding to proper treatment. Now, we normally would set the goal as 140 by 90 millimeters of mercury, above which we like to treat patients with high blood pressure. Now, if appropriate doses of at least 3 blood pressure medicines are given and the blood pressure still does not come below 140/90, we call it resistant hypertension, provided that the patient adheres to the lifestyle modification, the lifestyle measures which are advised to him, and is also diligent in taking his medicines. It is not an uncommon condition, as many of you would have seen, since high blood pressure is extremely prevalent in the society. I am sure there are 1 or 2 people suffering from hypertension in every household. Unless one measures blood pressure at home or in the doctor's clinic, it is never possible to know what the values are, because hypertension or high blood pressure rarely produces any symptoms till complications actually happen. So, by regular adherence to medicines, and that is the major issue, because people often stop taking medicines. A common expression that they give to us when they come for consultation is, "Mera to itna hi rehta hai, ye normal hai. 160/90 mujhe koi takleef nahi hai, isliye mera pressure normal hai." And then they will either take 1 or 2 pills or not take the medicines at all. One of the most important things to remember about high blood pressure is that one has to reduce salt intake, control body weight, do regular exercise, and then if required, medicines are to be provided. Most patients would need drug therapy. And if 3 drugs given in adequate doses, which the patient is able to tolerate without causing any side effects, are unable to control the blood pressure, then, you know, it becomes a very serious issue, because the chances of complications become very high, such as occurrence of heart attack, occurrence of heart failure, occurrence of stroke, occurrence of kidney disease, and so on. So many things will happen with it. Age is one such very, very important factor. As one grows older, particularly above the age of 70, you would have often noticed that the upper blood pressure or the systolic blood pressure that Dr. Pancholia alluded to keeps on rising, and the lower pressure or the diastolic pressure either remains normal or becomes slightly lower. Automatically, because of stiffening of the blood vessels in the body, the gap between the systolic and the diastolic blood pressure widens. So that is one situation where blood pressure becomes difficult to control. Then the body habitus or the body shape is an important thing. If somebody is overweight, it becomes difficult to control blood pressure. There are other medicines which people are often consuming, particularly medicines for controlling joint pains, and joint pain is a very, very common ailment in the society. So, if you are taking non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, as it is called in the medical parlance, drugs such as ibuprofen or similar drugs, then, you know, they often cause difficulty in controlling blood pressure. Similarly, people who do not discontinue smoking or tobacco chewers, one finds it difficult to control blood pressure. Also, there are certain other, you know, drugs. Many of them are like pleasure enhancing drugs like cocaine or any other addictive medication that people might be using, particularly the younger generation. That is a common cause for resistant hypertension. Then other, you know, small little things like licorice, you might be munching it all the time, and it is, you know, something which is deleterious towards blood pressure control. Kidney disease, if present, particularly when serum creatinine values are high, it's a situation where multiple drugs will be required, and blood pressure control becomes difficult. One of the other important thing is that the prescription which the doctor gives to the patient must contain at least 3 drugs which work by different mechanisms. So if the prescription combination is not right, and that is an issue that comes at the physician's end, then one, the physician should always think that if my blood pressure patient is not responding, am I giving the correct medicines? Am I giving the right combinations? And also, these days we talk about, you know, polypills, which means multiple medicines combined into one pill. Because if we write too many pills to the patient, he has to take, let's say, blood tablets for diabetes, which is very, very common. He has to take some medication for some other illness, and we give 4 or 5 medication for blood pressure control, then whole day the patient is taking medicines, and he often becomes fed up and therefore discontinues some of them. So we must combine drugs which have, you know, two or three medicines in one pill, so that once or twice daily administration of the medication is possible for improving patient compliance. So these are some of the important things that I think are critical. And if you still think that the patient is not responding in spite of the fact that he claims that he is taking all these medicines, then there is a situation which we call as white coat hypertension or white coat effect. That means that when the patient goes to the physician for getting his blood pressure checked, the blood pressure shoots up without the patient's knowledge, although he is not under stress because he is familiar with the physician. But that is one of the normal responses in the body that happens in many people, that when you go to the doctor, the blood pressure goes up. So in such circumstances, that should be a possibility that should be considered. And now we have automatic blood pressure recording instruments that we call them ambulatory blood pressure monitoring. You attach the instrument to the patient and send the patient home. It keeps recording the blood pressure automatically every half an hour during the daytime and less frequently during the night, which we can adjust according to the patient's requirement, but usually about once every hour. And that provides blood pressure readings which are most reliable in terms of our ability to manage patients, because they are without any environmental effects. They reflect what happens to the patient in its normal day-to-day routine. And also we advise them to tell or write down on a diary as to what time they took their medication and whether they felt any symptoms, whether they were standing or lying down when at least some of these blood pressure readings were taken, so that we know whether the blood pressure is higher during supine position. And many of them, you know, when they are sitting up or stand, the blood pressure becomes normal or low, so you don't actually get the correct reading. So this is another thing. And lastly, I would like to say that there are people who have the problem of snoring, what we call as obstructive sleep apnea, especially those who are overweight. They have excess sleep. Many of them sleep during the daytime, but they have very, very disturbed pattern of sleep at night. And this disease is present in people who are overweight, but can also happen in those who are not overweight. And obstructive sleep apnea is a very, very important cause of raising blood pressure, apart from many other complications that it can do. So snoring is not all that benign condition that somebody is happily sleeping and snoring away to glory. It is something which is causing complications and often results in loss of control of blood pressure. So that should be treated properly, again, by adapting a healthy lifestyle like regular exercise, walking, reducing salt, and reducing weight in general. And then CPAP or BiPAP therapy, whatever is advised to the patient, should be taken diligently and religiously so that the blood pressure can be brought under control. This is a very serious issue, because in busy hospitals such as ours, which are tertiary care centers, mostly difficult patients come. So they don't necessarily represent what is happening at the level of the community. But what we see, you know, there is a very, very high prevalence of difficult to control blood pressure patients. And as a society, as a country, we must put all our efforts to try to regulate this, try to control this as much as possible. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Sethi. Our next expert panelist, Dr. C.K. Pandey, who has come all the way from Mumbai. Dr. Pandey, you see so many patients in your hospital. When you do interventions or when we do any electrophysiological studies, what do you think is the commonest factor or number of factors responsible for resistant hypertension? Number one. Number two, do you think that the home BP monitoring has a role to clinical blood pressure monitoring? And if you compare home BP monitoring to ambulatory BP monitoring, which is superior? And we'd like to have your opinion. Do you see sleep apnea very often in obese patients or non-obese patients?
Thank you, Dr. Chopra. For the layman, I must say that when you talk of resistant hypertension, Dr. Sethi has given a definition that three drugs, one of them must contain a diuretic. Now, what is diuretic for a layman? A drug that excretes extra salt and water out of the system, out of our body. This drug is the primary drug for control of blood pressure. So one is this group and two other drugs from other groups. when used in maximally tolerable dosages, patient is taking those drugs regularly and yet the blood pressure is not controlled, we call it resistant hypertension. And when we get a patient of resistant so-called hypertension, the commonest factors in clinical practice as far as I see, and we have got a huge amount of data which we published just around 6 years ago from three institutes in Mumbai, and the three topmost factors which emerged was one, which Dr. KK Sethi has brought out very clearly, indiscriminate use of painkillers, NSAIDs, drugs which cause salt and water retention. Second, obstructive sleep apnea. Now, obstructive sleep apnea, for a layman, let me explain. In sleep, we have two patterns of sleep, rapid eye movement where our eyes flicker, and second, non-rapid eye movement where our eyes are absolutely still and steady. In obstructive sleep apnea, the upper airways, the passage of the air from the nose up to the larynx and the vocal cords and all the way down into the airways is obstructed. So patients tend to produce disturbed sleep. They tend to have carbon dioxide retention in the night in their blood. They become therefore excessively sleepy the next day, and their arteries tend to become stiff. And it indeed is a very important, commonly missed cause of resistant hypertension. So we ask leading questions to the spouse. Does your husband snore quite a bit? Snore very loudly, loud enough to disturb your sleep on a daily basis? Does his breath to you look like dangerously getting obstructed during sleep, choked during sleep? If the answers to these questions are yes, then possibly you are dealing with obstructive sleep apnea. The third commonest cause in my clinical practice is occult hypothyroidism. Thyroid is a small gland in the neck which secretes a hormone called thyroid hormone. And if this gland becomes hypo, that means less functional, the blood pressure keeps on rising. And tell you frankly, there are not much of symptoms hypothyroidism produces other than resistant hypertension and possibly weight gain. So if you ask the patient a question, have you without any reason, apparent reason, gained quite a few kgs in the last year or a half or so? Possibly do a thyroid profile. A simple blood test does not require fasting and you will be able to diagnose hypothyroidism and treat it. And the fourth and very important cause of resistant hypertension in clinical practice is atherosclerotic or long-standing hypertensive patients develop renal artery stenosis, which is atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis. And this can cause tremendous increase in the need of medications and resistant hypertension. So that, Dr. Chopra, may answer the first question. The second question of his is even more relevant, that patients come to our clinic for blood pressure once in 3 months, once in 4 months. And then we check a blood pressure after making them rest for 5 to 7 minutes in a quiet air conditioned room and take the first reading. If the first reading is high, we give another rest of 5 minutes and take another reading. Despite this protocol, there is an entity called white coat hypertension. What is this white coat? White coat is the coats which we as doctors wear, aprons as we call them. And in the olden era, a patient walking into the hospital and sees a person in the white coat reflexly develops 10 to 15 millimeters higher blood pressure than his normal blood pressure at home. This is called white coat. And you will tend to label this patient as hypertensive in inverted commas, start treating the patient, or might feel that this patient's blood pressure is not controlled. And an hour down the line, the patient walks into the home and takes the blood pressure at his home with his own blood pressure machine. And bingo, the blood pressure is normal. And therefore, all the International Society's guidelines today, 2017 guidelines, European Society of Hypertension, Canadian Society of Hypertension, and American Society of Hypertension, they all say that home blood pressure monitoring is an integral part of diagnosis in the first place of hypertension, to rule out white coat hypertension, and then to educate your patient. If the patient feels that he is involved in his own care, he is taking his blood pressure himself 3 times a day, 2 days a week, one working day, one holiday, that is my practice, and brings that diary back to me at 2 months, he feels, yes, I am involved in my own care. I am giving my own data to my own doctor to treat me better. It works phenomenally on the psyche of the patient and also to the morale of the patient to get involved in his own care. He is enthusiastic to tell me that data. And moreover, home blood pressure recordings, if they remain high, I know that this patient's blood pressure is really, really not well controlled. Doctor, that day I felt my blood pressure must have risen. Not must have. He has the machine at his home. He can check it. Doctor, I felt my blood pressure had risen, but when I checked with the machine, it was pretty normal. So the blood headache was possibly because of something else. And this is a very important information for the doctor. Ambulatory blood pressure is a step beyond home blood pressure. And what is it? It is a machine applied to your arm with a small pager-like device on the vest belt. And this machine is programmed to take blood pressure every 15 minutes in daytime and every 30 to 45 minutes in the sleeping period at night, automatically. So the patient can hook on the machine in the hospital, carry on home, do his all chores like going to the office, conducting meetings, conducting his professional activities, coming back home, watching television, reading a newspaper, except possibly having a bath. And that 24-hour blood pressure will tell us 3 important readings which the home blood pressure monitoring alone cannot give. And what are they? Very early morning surge of blood pressure, 5 a.m. to 8 a.m. This surge is responsible for strokes and heart attacks. And if not well controlled with appropriate timely dosage of a drug late in the night in the patient's life, then possibly you are not doing any good to the patient. Second is, in the sleep, normally the blood pressure drops. And ambulatory blood pressure is the only modality to tell you whether my patient has normal drop in blood pressure or no drop in blood pressure at all. So non-dippers or reverse dippers, patients whose blood pressure rises during sleep, are the worst candidates. And they need to be aggressively treated. So both these modalities are not exclusive. They are complementary to each other. And we, with Dr. Chopra, of course, and leading doctors in Delhi, we did an India heart study. The interim results are already out. And we came to know by applying home blood pressure monitoring that almost 10% of Indian population have masked hypertension. That is even worse, that their blood pressures are normal in the office, but very high at their own home. And why is that so? Nobody knows. World data also shows around 12% of hypertensives are masked hypertensives. And when they come to doctor's office, paradoxically their blood pressures are normal. So they are not treated and they land up in target organ damage like retinopathy, eye affection. Dr. Chopra said peripheral vascular disease like leg artery affection or heart attack or even a stroke, because they are simply not treated. And only home blood pressure monitoring will diagnose them. So I think these two modalities are really very important.
I think it's a very important, Dr. Pandey has clarified all the points.
And now I'll request Professor Gurpreet Singh Wander, who has come all the way from Ludhiana. I consider him as a guru of hypertension. He did a lot of work when he was in API. I think the first guidelines came in API on hypertension. He had a contribution, and recently, I read an article in Circulation written by him and Professor C. Venkatesh Ram. Very nice expression. I think he has a tremendous experience on the guidelines for hypertension care in India. We'd like to have your opinion, sir. What do you think are the API, CSI, AHA, or ACC, or what Dr. Pandey has just mentioned, Canadian guidelines? Are they applicable to India? What are your recommendations? for the control of blood pressure? What should be the target for the blood pressure? We really need your words because you have such a tremendous experience. What a common man should know? Are the guidelines or guidelines? Or the guidelines are only sidelines? Dr. Wander, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Chopra, for that beginning discussion on what guidelines are, because it's very important for the general public also to know that whatever medicines, whatever practices are used by doctors, they are based on huge number of studies and what we call in medical terminology, they are randomized studies. And then once there are significant number of data that is available in thousands of patients, then experts sit in various countries and they formulate guidelines, as Dr. Chopra is saying, so as to guide physicians, so as to guide the general public as to what today we live in an evidence-based era. We do not live in an era when a physician could say, this is my experience, this is my feeling, this is my thought. We only act when there is significant scientific evidence available and those practices are to be adopted. Why guidelines? Just now Dr. Pandey mentioned there are American guidelines, Canadian guidelines. Why there was a need for us to have the Indian guidelines? Because Indians are very different racially, our genetically we are so different, our seasonal variations are there, and our predecessors lived in famines. This data is now available from world over, whereas it was at one time considered that heart attacks are less common in third world countries. But today we know Indians who have migrated to various parts of the world, whether it is to UK, to Singapore, to Canada, there is data across the world that the vagaries or the end organ damage because of high blood pressure, that is heart attack, occurs 10 years earlier amongst Indians than natives of those areas. So we truly are a area or a population where some of these non-communicable diseases are increasing in their prevalence. And it is now realized that as our population in India is aging, when we got independence in 1947, average life longevity in India was 45 years or so. Today, the average longevity of life is 70 years in women and 67 years for males. It's not that we have reached the ultimate. Still, our longevity of life is much less than the Japanese, than the Britishers, than even some other communities. But the public health measures have made a significant difference. And in that, high blood pressure, and that's the mission which has been taken up today, because it is the commonest non-communicable. What are communicable diseases are? Which are communicated from one, like malaria, gastroenteritis, which can be acquired from another person. Non-communicable diseases are 50% dependent on your genetic makeup, of which you cannot really do too much. But 50% is dependent on your lifestyle, on how you spend your life, how much salt you are taking, how much fat you are taking, whether you are exercising regularly or not, whether you are doing yoga, meditation, relaxation, whether you are getting obese, how much fat you are taking. And if you are having a healthy lifestyle, you will be afflicted less often with these non-communicable diseases, which includes high blood pressure, diabetes, coronary artery disease, brain stroke, and cancers. And today it is realized that in the low middle income countries, 70% of the deaths are due to non-communicable diseases. And that's the reason Dr. Chopra has taken this Mission India, so as to make people aware that these non-communicable diseases are now more common amongst Indians as our population is aging. We are living longer to acquire these non-communicable diseases. We have handled public health issues. Our hygiene is better. Communicable diseases are somewhat less. But it is this new set of diseases that we are now acquiring. And so we thought that in India, since we have our own dietary patterns, genetically we are genetically prone to heart attacks, to brain strokes. So these Indian guidelines were formulated. And one thing very unique about Indian guidelines is that we talk about our dietary patterns. We take a lot of salt. Indians are a very high salt taking community. These papad, pickles, anything that is preserved, all these dietary elements are very high in salt. And then we add, our cooking is frying and we add a lot of salt. any preserved food. Now we are acquiring Western diet. We are acquiring diet which is high in fat and which is preserved. And now this new culture has come to our country. People are eating at home. They are getting food from outside. Food that is prepared outside the home has 1.7 times more fat and 1.5 times more salt. So any food that you are acquiring from these new carry home groups that have started will all be supplying you food that is high in salt and fat. So we warned Indian subjects. Another very important aspect in our Indian guidelines is what we realize that there is a significant urban-rural divide. The prevalence of high blood pressure in the urban areas is something like 35%, but in the rural areas it is 25%. So just the simple lifestyle of a ruralite, our traditional Indian lifestyle was more exercise, more walk, more fruits and vegetables in our diet, less fat, more exercise, relaxed, strong family connections, strong family support. All these things make a big difference towards the prevalence of high blood pressure. And recently the Americans came out with the American guidelines. They reduced the blood pressure level to 130 by 80. Alcohol is a very important factor. People who take alcohol, it's the commonest cause of acquired cause of high blood pressure, more fat intake, lack of exercise. And in case blood pressure does not come down, then they have to take drugs. And mostly these drugs are on a lifetime basis. A very important factor that we feel is poor compliance of, it has been touched upon by Dr. Chopra before also, patients do, because drugs have to be taken on a lifelong basis. And since high blood pressure does not cause any symptoms, a very important message that we would like to give under Mission India is, people who have a blood pressure of more than 140 by 90, in spite of lifestyle modification, they need to be on pills, they need to be on regular pills by their general physician, whatever he thinks is best for them. But on their part, regularity of taking medicine is very, very important. We in India do not feel the American population had 35% prevalence of hypertension. And with this additional increased load, almost 45% of America's population would have hypertension. So in Indian guidelines, we still stick to the 140 by 90 pressure. And we want to make our people, because only 10% of Indians at present in rural areas and 20% of Indians in urban area who have high blood pressure have blood pressures controlled. Rest 80% of them do not have blood pressures controlled. And if through such messages we are able to come across to people, make them realize that high blood pressure is a predecessor to heart attacks, to stroke. Both these fatal diseases are a consequence of high blood pressure. And if blood pressure remains high for a period of time, it keeps damaging your arteries on an incessant manner, and the arteries get affected, and so fat deposits in these arteries. If fat deposits in heart arteries, one succumbs to a heart attack. If it does so in the brain arteries, the blood pressure can damage the brain arteries and one can suffer from strokes. So public awareness is a mission that Dr. Chopra has taken, and under this Mission India, it is our participate in your treatment actively. Just now Dr. Pandey was saying home blood pressure recording. Know what your pressures are. Actively participate in your blood pressure monitoring and be regular in the therapy, so that the consequences, the end organ damage effects of blood pressure can be reduced in our public.
Thank you very much, Dr. Wander. I think the message is very clear, that the doctor and public partnership is the need of the hour. Dr. Wander was very specific. He said, grow younger and live longer with normal blood pressure. We'll proceed to our next panelist, as I already introduced to you. He's a very eminent person from Bengaluru, Professor C. N. Manjunath. I know him almost for the last 32 years. He is a very close friend of mine. And his contribution in the whole globe is known. He is in a very prestigious institute of India. Jayadeva Institute, Sri Jayadeva Institute is known to the whole globe in the field of cardiology. And he is the director there. Dr. Manjunath, you see so many patients of resistant hypertension. Yesterday you were discussing with me that there are 600 echoes done every day. It's amazing. I was alarmed, amazed to know the data, what information you were giving me yesterday. I have not heard of any institute in Delhi who is doing 600 echoes per day and in a very cost-effective manner. I think it was very, very lovely information. And we really want to work with you in a big way to reduce the menace of hypertension in public. My question to you, sir, do you really see this entity? And number two, do you really see entity when a patient has a uncontrolled or a resistant hypertension and they have a low pumping action of the heart and they go into so-called heart failure, number one. Number two, is heart failure different from sudden cardiac death? Because there's a little confusion in the public mind. What is heart failure? What is sudden cardiac death? And what is heart attack? Please define all the three terms in the public interest.
Thank you, Dr. Chopra, for taking, this initiative, India Mission, because India is facing the triple burden of cardiovascular disease, high blood pressure, and diabetes. As Professor Wander said, more than 50% of deaths in India are due to these lifestyle diseases. The most important in the management of high blood pressure is acceptance. So first, patients or persons has to accept that I have a blood pressure, then only treatment will be successful. So acceptance is in success of this treatment. That is one of the thing. And another important thing, high blood pressure, more than 50% of population do not know that they have a high blood pressure. And those who have a high blood pressure and taking medicine, more than 50%, it is not under control. So this is one of the important awareness need to be created. Not necessarily hypertension should have a lot of symptoms in the first few years of life. So it will be a silent as far as high blood pressure is concerned. Heart is a fascinating structure. It pumps nearly 6,000 liters of blood every day, only to emphasize the amount of stress heart is taking, because heart is one which can never sleep. So it is used to pump against a pressure of 120 or 130 millimeters of mercury blood pressure. So when there is a high blood pressure, so what is the definition of heart failure? Heart failure means the pumping capacity or horsepower of the heart is reduced. It is not able to pump the blood effectively so that rest of the body doesn't get the optimal quantities of blood. So that is the definition of, layman's definition of heart failure. And heart failure has two components. When heart contractility, or when the pumping of the heart is reduced, horsepower of the heart is reduced, we call it as systolic heart failure. When heart relaxation is reduced, we call it as a diastolic heart failure. And most important is, many are under the impression that heart function is 100%. Heart function is not 100%. Normal heart pumping function or pumping capacity is around 55 to 70%. So it is not 100%. So when once heart is pumping against a very high blood pressure or resistance, in fact, one of the common reason for resistant hypertension is the patients or people resistance to treatment. People resistant to take medication is one of the common cause for resistant hypertension. When heart is pumping against a high pressure, like 180 by 100 or 170 by 100 over a long period of time, as a result, heart enlarges, heart muscle also becomes thicker. This is exactly like if somebody is playing tennis with the right hand, his right forearm becomes very thick. If he is playing tennis with the left arm, his left arm forearm will be thicker. Like that, heart enlarges, heart weight also increases. Any heart, when the heart enlargement, enlarged heart is always, is bad as far as the patient is concerned. So the usual types of heart failure I have already alluded to, the symptoms of heart failure, because hypertension today is one of the important cause for heart failure. And an enlarged heart is more prone for sudden cardiac death. An enlarged heart is more prone for heart failure. So the symptoms of heart failure is exertion. When they start walking or when they start climbing, there will be a fatigue or a breathing difficulty, tiredness, and also there can be swelling of the legs. And most important symptom is when they are lying in the bed, after going to the sleep for a couple of hours, they get up with breathing difficulty. They are not comfortable lying flat. They are more comfortable sitting. That is one of the important ominous symptom of heart failure. Sometimes when patients have developed swelling of the legs, they are worried. It could be a serious problem. So today, one of the important cause of swelling of the leg is blood pressure reducing medicine. So one has to differentiate whether the swelling of the leg, because in heart failure, there is excess retention of salt and water in the body. In addition to breathlessness, in addition to tiredness and fatigue, if there is a weight gain, most likely it is a symptom of heart failure. And another important thing in an heart failure is early recognition of heart failure is very, very important. And today we have a very important investigation. After physical examination, ECG is one of the important thing that shows whether heart is enlarged, whether heart has become thicker. Then echocardiography is one of the gold standard for recognizing and confirming the diagnosis of heart failure. An echocardiogram is today is a very simple test, and we should also check for other blood tests such as for hemoglobin, because today 30 to 40% of Indians, more often from the rural area, they have a low hemoglobin. So correction of hemoglobin itself can relieve some of the symptoms of heart failure. Then you should also check for your kidney function, such as urea, creatinine, and electrolytes. And another very simple test is there, what is called NT-proBNP. If somebody complains of breathlessness, fatigue, tiredness, these are some of the important basic symptoms of heart failure. And if this blood test is done, that will tell us whether this breathing difficulty is due to heart disease or whether is breathing difficulty is not due to heart disease. This is how we can arrive at a simple diagnosis. Another entity, we have what is called broken heart syndrome. Whenever there is a tragedy in the family, then there is a tragedy in your career. When there is a sudden shock, even an apparent at that time blood pressure goes up, and some of these patients develop heart failure or almost like an heart attack like a thing, and ECG will be abnormal. And this is one of the most common cause of sudden onset of heart failure in a patient, in a person who are apparently normal. And most important, the anger is also one of the reason for sudden rise of blood pressure and heart failure worsening. Results of anger are more painful than the reasons of anger. So results of anger are more painful than the reasons of anger. So definitely hypertension is one of the important cause for heart failure. It has been already alluded to, optimal control. Many a time what patients do, when they are taking medicine, on medicine blood pressure is normal, and then on their own they stop thinking that, oh, my blood pressure is normal, let me stop. Then they come back after a couple of weeks, then blood pressure has gone high again. So one has to realize on medication, if blood pressure is normal, it's not truly normal. It is because of medication it has come to normal. And again, another important cause for heart failure, it has been already discussed, is obstructive sleep apnea, obesity. And in females, despite pumping capacity being normal, some of these patients can still have these symptoms of heart failure. Yes, definitely this is one of the treatable cause of heart failure. If medication need to be taken particularly water, and when a patient develops a heart failure, most important is salt restriction and water restriction, apart from some of the medicines that have been described. And sometimes high blood pressure can also cause irregular heartbeat, what we call it as atrial fibrillation. This can worsen heart failure. All of a sudden, when the heartbeat becomes faster and when becomes irregular, then it always it can precipitate heart failure. So this is how it goes. Then sudden cardiac death is one of the real problem. Apparently normal person with high blood pressure, I already said a heart enlargement or heart which is hypertrophied or heart muscle which has become very thick, they can they are more prone for sudden cardiac death. For this there are some medications, there are some devices. So ultimately five things are very, very important. Five S's you can say, or five the first S, you have to take care of these five S's. That is stress, then salt, then spirit, smoking, sedentary life. Probably then we can reduce this burden of hypertension and its related complications such as heart failure. And another important cause for heart failure in an hypertensive patient is the hypertensive or high blood pressure patients are more prone for heart attack compared to those with normal blood pressure. When somebody develops a heart attack, heart function can come down, resulting in heart failure. Heart failure is not synonymous with cardiac arrest. That I think heart failure, many people are trying to confuse heart failure, and where cardiac arrest means heart stops, then it has to be revived, and some lucky one gets revived. In heart failure, patient will be alive, but he will not able to perform his routine physical activity.
I think Professor C. N. Manjunath has clarified very lucid way. We need to advocate some technology, like a hand device.
Handheld device.
Yeah, hand device for echo. And we should see in every patient at home or everywhere to see whether the heart is functioning normally or not normally. That may help us to reduce the morbidity and mortality and keep us away from the heart failure. To my left is Dr. M.K. Das, who has come all the way from Calcutta. On a very short notice, he was in Patna for a conference. And he is the president-elect of Cardiological Society of India, which is the most prestigious society of India, almost 70, 80 years old now. We all have learned whatever we are speaking today is all because of CSI. We all are educated and we learn on daily basis in CSI. He's a very eminent interventional cardiologist, as I introduced to you. When you see resistant hypertension, do you see these symptoms are there or they are not there? They're all silent. Or you see when the patient come to you only with the symptoms like a organ damage. We'd like to have your opinion on this. Number two, you put so many pacemakers or do so many electrophysiology. Do you think the management of this patient is a little different when they were resistant hypertension, or the management is same? Dr. M.K. Das, sir.
I'm very thankful to Dr. H.K. Chopra for calling me on a very short notice to this particular mission, Mission India, which has been organized by IPCA. This is a very, very important mission to transmit the messages from the horse's mouths, that is the experts in cardiology. In fact, Cardiological Society of India started its journey in 1948. It was late Dr. B.C. Roy, who was the founder president of this great organization. And the main idea was to send messages to the people, educate the doctors as well as the patients, and do research works in the field of cardiovascular sciences, which was in a very, very nascent stage in 1948. With the same mission, Cardiological Society of India is propagating the latest information to all the cardiologists and physicians treating cardiology patients, and also doing a lot of works to pass the messages to the people so that they become part of the whole therapeutic procedure or therapeutic interventions. CSI is organizing World Heart Day in a very, very big way. There are 27 branches, all of them are organizing the World Heart Day. And they are organizing seminars, symposium, where people are involved. And all of you have heard so many aspects of the development of hypertension and resistant hypertension from the different experts. What Dr. Chopra has asked me is whether there can be symptom or not. It's very interesting to tell you in a different way. In 2015, this is called SNAP registry for hypertension amongst the people in the whole country, where 1,82,000 people were screened at different cities in our country. And there, to our dismay, we found that almost 30% people are not at all aware about the existence of hypertension. So you can imagine what a high percentage of people are not at all aware, or in other words, they don't know the symptoms, or they don't feel about the symptoms. Now, why it is so? Why the symptoms are not there? There are many aspects of it. Definitely, socioeconomic factors are very, very important. As Dr. Wander was telling about the rural and urban divide, urban peoples are more educated, rural people are not. And at the same time, the sex is also very important, males and females. The females, mostly, they ignore symptoms. Even if some grave symptom is there, headache, oh, kuch nahi hai, ye aisa to hote hi rata hai, mera mataji ka bhi hota tha. So that sort of ignorance, that sort of inertia, I'll use this word repeatedly, inertia, is very much there amongst the patients, and more so with the rural people, where they can't interpret anything. And that's the reason why the blood pressure and resistant hypertension are gradually increasing, because hypertension is just a starting process. It starts, then it perpetuates. How it perpetuates? As already highlighted, it affects most of the organs, the vessels, and the remodeling of the vessels ultimately perpetuate the process of hypertension, and that results in resistant hypertension at later point of time. So, what are the symptoms? Many a time, hamara jo patient log aate hain, wo log bolte hain, mera ghabrahat ho raha, ghabrahat. And this ghabrahat is such an important symptom for many diseases. I think Dr. Wander is an expert, because he is dealing with the Association of Physicians of India, where even in a book the definition of ghabrahat was defined in a very, very different way and multiple ways. And ghabrahat for us, the cardiologist and physician, is to some extent palpitation and discomfort, uneasiness, and this uneasiness is mostly ignored. Same way, headache, fatigue, breathlessness, as Dr. Manjunath was telling, the pressure, blood pressure is an afterload. You are pushing this hand, this is the afterload. If it is giving more pressure, it this my right hand cannot go forward. And same thing happens with the high blood pressure, or more so with the resistant hypertension or very, very high blood pressure, which is uncontrollable. So this kind of pressure after load actually produces lot of diseases or lot of remodeling in the heart itself, and that heart cannot cope up and ultimately gives in different ways. Different ways means it can produce vascular disorder in the form of stroke, in the form of heart attack, in the form of kidney failure, in the form of peripheral arterial disease, that is the arteries supplying the distant part of the body, or in heart to heart attack, then to the muscle damage which is occurring due to the high blood pressure, that is the afterload, may cause sudden heart failure, which is also known as relaxation failure or diastolic heart failure. Same way, the abnormality occurring inside the musculature of the heart may give rise to irregular heartbeat or irregular rhythm disorder. So that irregular rhythm can cause sudden cardiac death, not only the discomfort, palpitation, gavrat. So the most important thing I would like to tell all of you, stitch in time saves nine. Stitch in time saves nine. So if you can take care of the hypertension early, then automatically you are preventing the many diseases which have been highlighted. Now, next question was whether the different kind of device therapies or different kinds of pacemakers or these kind of things are there or not. The answer is yes. But what have been said by all other experts, they must be ritually followed not only by the physicians but also by the patients. I always highlight this particular aspect: inertia of the doctor and inertia of the patients ultimately result in inertia mediated hypertension, which I would call as resistant hypertension. So first thing is lifestyle, drugs, and all these will have to be followed. There is no doubt about that. Only when they are really, really resistant to the drugs, lifestyle measures, and all the sleep disorders have been corrected, salt intake have been corrected, then only we'll go for certain special kind of therapies. One of them already, as a passing comment, was made like renal artery stenosis. That renal artery stenosis can be taken care of by two modes of therapies. One is the angioplasty of the renal artery, where the renal artery circulation is allowed to made more, and thereby it influences to some extent, not in all patients, to some extent it can take care of certain resistant hypertension patients. There is another mode of therapy known as renal nerve denervation, which can take care of resistant hypertension and to moderate to severe hypertension, and then of course the resistant hypertension. They are still in the experimental phase. There is one pacemaker like thing which can really help. They have shown efficacy. It is said that some pacemakers can be put where some stimulus coming from one particular organ known as baroreceptors. So from the baroreceptors, if the impulse is taken into the pacemaker and they are not allowed to do its function, then this baroreceptor mechanism can take care of the resistant hypertension or sometimes the uncontrolled hypertension. But I'll say definitely that these are all experimental, or only the last resorts. Will have to follow the lifestyles, and for lifestyle I'll give a message in the form of one or two lines which I have written. It has been published in Indian Heart Journal. Give thy hands is the name of the poem. So the two lines are, give thy hands, give thy hearts to whosoever. Give thy hands, give thy hearts to whosoever. Enjoy the life, enjoy the heart, enjoy your heart forever. Thank you very much.
Now we ask the next and the last panelist, but a very important panelist. He's looking at me, when is my turn coming? So he's Dr. Viveka Kumar, who is a director, a very senior director of a very prestigious institute of Delhi, Max Heart and Vascular Institute. His work is known all over the world. He is an interventional cardiologist par excellence. His work in electrophysiology is very widely known. And I think he's there in all the programs which we've done so far. Dr. Viveka, we are very, very grateful to you. Dr. Viveka Kumar, I just one question. How should we investigate this patient of resistant hypertension? What should be the message for people? Everybody should know. Because we discussed where is the resistance, maybe in the blood vessel, maybe in the biochemistry, maybe in the faulty methods of blood pressure measurement, maybe in the mindset. Whatever may be the cause of resistance or resistance in the blood vessel, how should we investigate? Two things are mentioned by Dr. Pandey, home BP monitoring and by ambulatory BP monitoring. What are the other methods by which we can say he is the patient with a resistant hypertension and these are what the complications he has so far? Number two, you do so many interventions, sir. Coronary interventions every day, lot of MI, lot of acute coronary syndrome. Do you come across resistant hypertension quite often? And do you feel that the outcome of these patients is different as compared to those who are non-hypertensive? And the last question is, what is the relationship of resistant hypertension with CKD, chronic kidney disease, and with diabetes? Because it's very common in India. We'd like to have your words of wisdom, Dr. Viveka, sir.
Yeah, so thank you, Dr. Chopra, for inviting me and IPCA and FAM Health for making this event happen. At the outset, I would like to say that, you know, the questions about resistant hypertension is really pertinent, and in a country which is grappling with acceptance of disease of hypertension, you can imagine the resistant hypertension is something which has, you know, gone into something where people don't talk much about it, because we are, you know, putting a lot of effort to convince the patient that look, you have got high blood pressure and must start the treatment. Now the question comes that those who have accepted that he has or she has hypertension, despite, as it was elucidated before also, despite maximum tolerated or guideline based medication of three medicines including one diuretic, the patient continues to be hypertensive. And when we define resistant hypertension, we are not talking about pseudo-resistant hypertension, or we are not talking about, you know, miscalculated or wrong readings. When we are saying resistant hypertension, we had excluded that, meaning thereby that we are getting, you know, including the home monitoring of the blood pressure, the three readings of average which Sarca blood pressure instrument does. We have also have to take the help of ambulatory 24-hour ambulatory blood pressure monitoring. And once we are sure that the person is having blood pressure consistently more than 140/90 despite three medication in maximum tolerable dose, then we have to label them as resistant hypertension. The history goes back when the Simplicity trial for renal denervation therapy was started, and you would know there were three Simplicity trials, and there the definition and the medications for resistant hypertension was, you know, defined in different trials. In fact, Simplicity 3, the data went up to 5 antihypertensive agents, so patient had to be on 5 antihypertensive agents and including one diuretic which is spironolactone, and then only we have to label them resistant hypertension. Resistant hypertension is menace, and it can cause all the target organ damage, because we know from data that if you decrease the blood pressure systolic by 2 millimeters of mercury, then you can decrease the cardiovascular event stroke rates significantly lower. So there is no denial in fact, and if the person continues to have resistant hypertension, then we have to go beyond pharmacological agents. So the person has to be, so sometimes we see the lifestyle modification has not been adequately imparted. So you can't have the, you know, very well controlled hypertension or in a patient who is not compliant with salt intake, exercise, and the, you know, adequate sleep, and sleep apnea has also been included in that. So I think these are certain 5-6 reversible causes which can bring in them in a comfortable zone. As far as the intervention in these situations are concerned, after the negative data from Simplicity 3 trial, it's not a guideline indicated treatment, but still there are many countries, especially in Australia, where this therapy is still going on in patients who are having resistant hypertension, and also to decrease the pill burden in them. Then the target organ damage is very, very important, and we need to educate our patient and the society that, you know, control of hypertension is one thing which can bring down the health budget of all other diseases significantly low. So we have to invest in one disease, that is hypertension, and then you can see the decreased number of CKD patients who are having dialysis, and also people who the ICU burden of heart attack will come down. So I think this is, if we ask the healthcare policy makers, then we need to convince them that this is one disease where they had to invest maximally so that the other diseases' healthcare burden comes down significantly. Then, as you said, in our current practice, whether when we are doing, so many coronary interventions and devices, the incidence of resistant hypertension. So I think all of us sitting here would agree that being in a tertiary center, we tend to get more resistant hypertension because we get reference from our physician colleagues and, the other subspecialty colleagues that, you know, this is a patient who has, so we get a lot of references from even people, surgeons, that look, we have planned 3 times surgery for this patient and every time the blood pressure is 160. So one of the reasons why they would not take this patient for surgery, but obviously there'll be a lot of bleeding if the blood pressure is high. So we get a lot of references from the other subspecialties as well. And our patients also would have, you know, significantly higher resistant hypertension. We see that the CKD or chronic kidney disease is one of the most difficult uncontrolled hypertensive patients are there, and you would agree that the moment you read a prescription, you can clearly say that this is a prescription of a nephrologist, because anything available on the planet would be in that prescription to control the blood pressure, and still the blood pressure is not well controlled. So I would say that the CKD is not only the effect of uncontrolled high blood pressure, but also the cause of, because the hormonal imbalance, because the renin secretion and all from the kidney would cause this cycle, go into vicious cycle and cause severe hypertension. We must invest in regular health check, and the blood pressure measurement and control should be integral part of that. By virtue of that, we can decrease the number of, you know, heart attacks, we can decrease the number of dialysis, renal transplant, and of course the so many procedures.
Very nice expression by a very famous interventional cardiologist. And last, ladies and gentlemen, I express my gratitude and thanks to very eminent panelists, Dr. Pandey, Dr. Wanda, Dr. Manjunath, Dr. M.K. Das, Dr. Veka Kumar, Dr. A.K. Pancholia, who has all come from different parts of India, and Professor Siti, who is not here. I also express my gratitude and thanks for the kind gesture of IPCA, who are all the time with us. And in the last, I am very grateful to the Health Channel, Tata Sky Fam Health, for organizing this program in a very structured manner. And I'm sure they will try to cover this in a very vast level so that every person, every public member is educated. Thank you very much for being with us. With this, we conclude the session. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we just heard Professor Manjunath, and his message was very clear that we should laugh. Today, we take a pledge on the occasion of Mission India. Hypertension care, time to act is now,
we all take a pledge to start this campaign of laughter right from this platform of Tata Sky Fam Health under the academic partnership of IPCA. Please laugh.
Good.
So laughter is the biggest message to control the blood pressure, and we should do it on a daily basis. Thank you very much. Thanks.